Mr. Taru, in this video, we're going to take a look at a four-part question involving Taylor polynomials and the upper bound, or the Lagrange error, the upper bound of that error. In the description, you'll find timestamps to jump ahead to each of the four parts of this video, and describing what those four parts are, you'll find a link to the APCentral website where you can download old exams, marking schemes, graders, commentaries to see where students earned and did not earn their points. I'm also going to put the links to the playlist that I've done for Calculus AB, Calculus BC, and these videos I'm helping creating to help you review for your AP test. If you like the video, please remember to smash the like button so that we help out the YouTube algorithm and more people can see my videos. Thank you very much if you do that. So we have here basically, unless otherwise noted, the domain of f is assumed to be the set of all real numbers x for which f of x is a real number. The function f has derivatives of all orders for all real numbers. Okay, so with that technicality out of the way, we have our table of values describing this function f, okay? So we're not to the Taylor polynomial yet. We haven't created a polynomial that represents this function within possibly some interval of convergence. But we just asked that part A here, that we want to write an equation for the line tangent to the graph of f at x equals 2, and then use that to approximate f of 2.5. So we have a little bit of linear approximation here. Well, what do you need to write the equation of a line? You need a point and a slope, and this is really a calculus AB question. You could argue it's just an algebra question. Well, we have at the point, or the independent variable, the x equals 2, we have a y value of 5, so we've got the point of 2, 5. We have a slope, not here, that's for something else. We have that the slope, or f prime of 2, is equal to negative 8. So we have a point of tangency, and therefore a line that is tangent to the graph f of x of y minus 5 is equal to negative 8 times x minus 2. AP generally, this isn't a question necessarily, well, it is. They're asking for the equation of the tangent line, and they're generally not happy unless you get that equation into slope-intercept form. So we're going to distribute the negative 8, and then add by 5, and we have y is equal to negative 8x. Negative 8 times negative 2 is positive 16. Positive 16 plus 5 is going to be equal to 21. Just double check here. I mean, it's just some simple algebra, but arithmetic. But that is our equation of the tangent line. Now, as far as using the line to do a linear approximation, I really prefer to use the equation of the line in point slope form. Just, I don't know, works better for me mentally. And then also, with this being a non-calculator question, our approximation here, that f of 2.5 is going to be approximately equal to what we get out of the function. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say for the tangent line that, well, actually I'm drawing this arrow, but that should not be there. Those aren't really going to be equal. We have y minus 5 is equal to negative 8 times 2 1/2 minus 2, which means we're looking at y is equal to negative 8 times 1/2 plus 5. Well, half of 8 is going to be 4, so we're looking at negative 4 plus 5, which is equal to 1. So while we're getting the y value of 1 from the tangent line at the value of 2.5, that's not the actual value for the function, it's just an approximation. So f of 2.5, based off of this calculation, is approximately equal to 1. So for part B, it says write a third degree Taylor polynomial for f about x equals 2 and use it to approximate f of 2.5. So another approximation, not this time not a linear approximation, but using the Taylor polynomial to approximate the actual function's value at 2.5. Is there enough information to determine whether f has a critical point at 2.5 with the given information? Okay, well, first of all, our Taylor polynomial, a third degree. So we're looking for a third degree Taylor polynomial, and that is going to be centered about x is equal to 2, because that's the actual information, that we have, that f of 2 is equal to 0.5. So we have, we're going to base this off of f of 2, and then that is going to be then plus f prime of 2 over 1 factorial, and then we have that x minus c, or 2, to the first, and then f double prime of 2 over 2 factorial times x minus c squared, and then finally, plus our last term, f the third derivative, f triple prime, I guess, of 2 over 3 factorial times x minus c cubed. So our third degree Taylor polynomial, which is centered around x is equal to 2, is going to be equal to, well, f of 2 is equal to 5, f prime of 2 is equal to negative 8, so 5 minus 8, 1 factorial is 1, so negative 8 times x minus 2 to the first, plus the f double prime of 2 off the table is given to us as 12 over 2 factorial, x minus 2 squared, and then the third derivative, or f, the third derivative of f at 2 is equal to negative 18, so plus a negative, or minus 18 over 3 factorial, times x minus 2 cubed. So that cleaned up is, double check here. Good. 5 minus 8 times x minus 2 plus 6 times x minus 2 squared minus 3 times x minus 2 to the third power. Third power, third degree Taylor polynomial. Now we want to use this Taylor polynomial to estimate the value of f of 2.5. So we're looking at f of 2.5 is going to be approximately equal to, not exactly equal to what we get from the Taylor polynomial, of 5 minus 8 times 2.5 minus 2 is 1/2, plus 6 times 1/2 squared minus 3 times 1/2 cubed. Yeah, so we got common denominators, 40 over 8 minus 32 over 8 plus 6 over, not 6, but 12 over 8 minus 3 over 8. So we're looking at 40, now it's 8, now it's 20, now it's 17 over 8. So with the Taylor polynomial, we have an approximation of f of 2.5, which is equal to 17 over 8. Now, can we use this Taylor polynomial right here? Is there some way that that is going to help us to determine, is there enough information to determine whether f has a critical point at 2.5? Your Taylor polynomial can give you exact values for a function if the Taylor series actually, within that interval convergence, if the Taylor series converges back to the original function of f of x. And we just don't even simply have that information. We don't even have enough information for, even what is the interval of convergence. So we don't have enough information to determine whether f has a critical value at 2.5. In other words, we can't determine if f prime of 2.5 is equal to 0, thus, or being undefined, thus giving you a critical value. So this is all we can determine for this particular problem. Let's get on to part C, which is going to be involving our Lagrange error, the upper bound or upper error of the Lagrange. Let's get to part C, which deals with the Lagrange error value, the upper bound of that error. No, And for part C, take two, because my microphone battery died and it was just a bunch of static. I did catch, by the way, I spelt Lagrange without an E at the end. Nice job, math teacher. Okay. The fourth derivative of f satisfies the inequality that the fourth derivative, the absolute value of the fourth derivative of f of x, is less than or equal to 36 for all x greater than 2. Use the Lagrange error bound, the upper bound, okay, to show that the approximation found in B differs from f of 2.5 by no more than 3/32, or 3/32. Okay, so let's remember that the actual error that you get from a Taylor polynomial or approximation is going to be less than or equal to the absolute value of R sub n of x. The remainder that is to the sort of, you know, matches that degree of your Taylor polynomial. And that remainder is equal to the absolute value of f of x, the value of the actual function at some value of x that you're trying to estimate, minus the value that you got from your Taylor polynomial. And the Lagrange error here, the R sub n of x, is equal to, well, it's equal to f, the n plus 1 derivative of f at z, or at least this is how it's presented in the Larson calculus book that I'm teaching from, over n plus 1 factorial times x minus c to the n plus 1 power. Now, your book, and you may see, like on a marking scheme from APCentral, AP Calculus, that this might be something like max for the maximum of the absolute value of f of n plus 1 of x. My book defines z as the value on the closed interval from, not my book, but z is a value on the closed interval from x to c. X, again, the value, the independent variable or value that you're trying to estimate the function at, and c is the center of the Taylor polynomial or Taylor series. And so this is supposed to be telling you, yes, I want the z value that maximizes the value of that derivative. Now, if it says maximum or max absolute value of f of n plus 1 of x, same idea, just different notation. And what you're going to see in a second, as we go back to the actual regular recording, is we have that fourth derivative of f of x is 24, but we want to use the absolute maximum possible value that that fourth derivative could come up with. So that's why we're going to be using the value of 36 and not the value of 24 in the rest of this example. So with this recalled, we want to make sure that we show that that error, right, is no more than that 3/32. So that error is going to be less than or equal to the absolute value of, and wrote this being a, or that in part B we used a third degree Taylor polynomial, we're going to be looking at the fourth derivative of z over 4 factorial times x. Well, that x is specifically, we're talking about the error where we're estimating at the x value of 2 1/2 minus the center of our Taylor polynomial, which is 2 to the 4th power. Not c, but 2 to the 4th power. And that is going to be, we're going to make sure that we're showing that it's less than or equal to 3/32. Now, we do have in our table that the fourth derivative of f of x is equal to 24, but we're trying to make sure that we realize, you know, calculate that upper bound of the error. Like, what's the largest possible error that we're going to get from this Taylor polynomial? So we're going to be using, again, right, that, depending on the book's notation, that z, which maximizes the value of this derivative on the closed interval from x to c, or just the fact that we're told that the value is going to be less than or equal to 36 for all x that are greater than 2. So we're actually going to be using the 36 here. So we have the absolute value of, and these are going to be positive numbers, but I'll drop it on the next line, 36. 4 factorial is going to be 24, 4 times 3 times 2, course we know that, but. And we're looking at 2 1/2 minus 2, which of course we know is 1/2 to the fourth power. That's going to be 3 over 2 times 1 over 2, 4, 8, 16. And that is going to be, well, our 3 over 32. So we have shown that our error is always going to be less than or equal to, we verified that that is always going to be less than or equal to 3 over 32. We got part B coming up, or part D, excuse me, coming up right now. And for our last and final part of the question, what is the coefficient of the x minus 2 to the third term of the Taylor series for f prime, the derivative of f, about x is equal to 2? Okay, so you could just like basically write this answer immediately if you really have a complete, total, super strong grasp on what's going on, or we can just say, which is hopefully you do, but we're going to say, I'm going to write out just for teaching purposes, that fourth degree Taylor polynomial, which of course is just going to be the third degree Taylor polynomial with another term on it. So we had that 5 minus 8 times x minus 2 plus 6 times x minus 2, I could have just left the work up from the previous problem, squared minus 3, x minus 2 cubed. Now that fourth term is going to come from what? It's going to come from plus the fourth derivative of f of x, which is 24 over 4 factorial times x minus 2 to the fourth. And let's see here. Well, let's see. 4 times 3 times 2 is 24. So 24 over 24 is equal to 1. Now, remembering that they're trying to make sure you read the question carefully. The coefficient of the x minus 2 to the third term, no, not the third term of the Taylor series, but for f prime, which means that we want to basically, we can look at the Taylor just polynomial, not the full-blown series necessarily. That would just overcomplicate it if you were trying to come up with that series, that general term for the series notation. The derivative of 5 is 0. Constant. The derivative of negative 8, you don't really need all these previous terms, but the derivative of negative 8 times x minus 2 is negative 8. Our next term here is going to be 2 times 6, which is 12. Continuing on, 3 times negative 3 is negative 9. And reduce that power by 1. And finally, what we really care about is the 4 times 1 is 4 times x minus 2 cubed. And that is the coefficient that we're looking for. Just reword the question, the coefficient of the x minus 2 cubed term of the Taylor series for f, or for f prime, is 4. I miss it true. Bam! Go do your homework.